Our subject today deals with practicing mystical oneness with God on a daily basis. Now, what does that mean? Well, obviously, if a person believes in God, attributes a lot of their reality, in fact, all of their reality to God, that's fine. But what do we do on a day-to-day basis when things try to veer us away from that reality? What do we do to try to stay in that particular spiritual groove, as it were? There's a quotation in the Bhagavad Gita, the Hindu gospel, that goes, "Even a mind that knows the path can stray from the path, for the senses are so unruly. But the seer recollects his mind and fixes it on me. I call him a seer and I call him illumined." In a day-to-day basis, in an ever-changing world, it is very, very easy for any of us to become detoured away from a sense of oneness with God. So many things are vying for our attention. Everywhere we turn, something is happening. It's almost as if we are on a merry-go-round in this world of rapid changes, and in those rapid changes, we try to find a sense of peace, a sense of certainty, a sense of security, and a sense of love. We can, of course, only find that in ourselves, but if we practice this reality on a day-to-day basis, we keep attuned to it. There was a book that became a classic in the spiritual field many, many years ago. It was written by a brother Lawrence, and it was simply called Practicing the Presence. It's a very little tiny book. It's one of those little tiny books that you pick up that has a world of wisdom in it. And I'm sure some of you have picked up little spiritual books at one time or another. You say, boy, this is better than some of the big ones that I've read. Well, the idea of practicing the presence with Brother Lawrence was the idea that he was a monk and he was given all of the chores of the monastery. And he accepted them wholeheartedly. And as he accepted them, whatever he had to do, whether it was to do the dishes after the evening meal or whether it was to clean the latrines, whatever it was, he did it joyfully. Because he was, in essence, practicing almost karma yoga. That is, everything that he did was a contribution to God. He dedicated everything that he did. Whether he was mopping the floor, I'm mopping the floor and I dedicate it to the presence. I'm washing the dishes and I dedicate it to the presence, including the drying. Whatever it is, the whole thing. Now, when a person has that type of attitude, it is very, very hard to build up a sense of resentment, a sense of hostility. In other words, he could have said, why aren't the other people here in this place doing some of these things? Why do I always get stuck with kitchen duty, etc., etc.? How many people today are resentful of other people that they work with and maybe have a higher position? How many people are resentful that they don't have a particular type of personal relationship in their life? How many people are just simply dissatisfied and unhappy? Now, if a person is dissatisfied and unhappy, and it really gnaws at them, then they are not practicing the presence. I know people who are walking encyclopedias of spiritual knowledge and are unhappy people. They blame people, they criticize people, they live a life that is anything but practicing the presence. Because if you practice the presence, you're not an unhappy person. You smile a lot, you laugh a lot, and even with problems, you still manage to enjoy life. Why? Because you focus in on your own reality. It's so easy to become depressed. I'm sure all of you can agree on that. There are so many things that we can get to depress us. So many people that we know Just the very thought of, if we allowed it, could depress us, could anger us. But if we recollect our minds, as it were, and fix it upon our reality, then we are practicing the presence. We are practicing mysticism, because what is mysticism? Mysticism is our attempt at reaching union with God. And once that has been reached in a mystical state of meditation, to allow the rest of our life to become an after vibration of that experience. It's the same as taking a little pebble and throwing it into a brook. When it hits the brook, that's cosmic consciousness as a parallel. For the rest of our life, the ripples that come from that initial touching of the pebble into the water becomes the afterlife that all of us should be living. And so, day by day, we begin to practice the presence. And as we practice the presence, things that otherwise would trouble us don't trouble us. And because we are untroubled, it allows us to have a clearer mind. And when you have a clearer mind, you can see more into the depths of yourself and what to do in any given situation. When you have a clearer mind, the creative intelligence inside of you, which is God, has more of an opportunity to come through and to guide you, to lead you intuitively. You see, we junk up the conscious part of our minds. Instead of practicing the presence of God, we practice junk. We practice negativity in our minds. We fill our minds with fear, doubt, hesitation, confusion. We fill our minds with hostility, hate, anger. And it's very, very easy to do this on a day-to-day basis. Well, when we do this on a day-to-day basis, then over a period of time, we become desensitized to the presence within us. We are more caught up in our outer sense activity than we are centered and grounded in the divine presence within ourselves. And so practicing mysticism on a daily basis is practicing our oneness with God and keeping centered on that oneness so that we do not become diverted, because the moment we become diverted, we get caught up in the energy of this outer world. And the energy of this outer world right now, and I'm sure all of you will agree with it, and it's just varies in how it plays out from one year to the next, is an unstable world. Basically, we were born psychologically into a neurotic world, a world that is really basically upside down. And so when Christ, as an example, said, I'm in this world but not of it, I'm not part of this neurotic scene that's all around me here. I'm not part of all of this where people cannot see life as one, but everybody wants to judge everybody else, and everybody wants to cast that first stone upon everybody else. It wasn't like that, and it wasn't meant to be like that. Ultimately, there is one life in this universe, and all of us are varying manifestations of that one life. When Jesus said, he has seen me, has seen the Father that has sent me, that applies to every one of us. Because every one of us is a manifestation of God. We have a personality which is let's pretend so that we can have creation throughout the universe. That's the only reason. We are all actors and actresses right now, but we're only one life in this room. One life on this planet. But that one life, in order, again, to have creation, has to give the illusion of dividing itself up into many. That's why St. Paul said in the Bible, we are all members of one universal body. When he saw a group of people, he said, hail to the churches of Christ. There weren't steeples there. There weren't temples there. There weren't cathedrals there. There were people there. So every person there was a church of Christ, a temple. because everyone contains the very same thing within themselves. So the idea of practicing the presence is very, very difficult, but yet not impossible. Again, when you turn on your televisions in the morning, if you get a morning news broadcast, obviously, it is not the most inspiring thing, but you can get caught up and swept up into what you're seeing. You have to feel almost objective. If you're practicing the presence of God, you sort of revert back. I remember when I was a little boy, and I've mentioned this to some of you before, and I was growing up, and Hearst had the Hearst newspapers, and this was in Los Angeles, and I would get the comics in the morning, and up at the top was this little caricature, and it said, "What fools these mortals be." And so this is it. We look, we bless the mortals, we realize that they're all part of our own manifestation, but we realize that there is a foolishness here when you get caught up and trapped into the idea of division. Remember, division of the one life is only to give the appearance of creation or manifestation. If you get caught up in the division, then you become the proverbial house divided against itself. And the idea is, a house divided against itself can't stand. You can't worship two masters. You can't worship illusion and truth at the same time. They cancel each other out. Do you see that? So we have to be real. And the greatest reality is this one life. Now let's turn to our affirmation sheet for this morning. Obviously, the first thing that always keeps us attuned is meditation. You have to, and I use the word have to, take time to keep that oneness. What is more important to you than keeping that oneness? I don't know of anything more important. I'd rather miss a meal and keep the oneness. I'd rather miss all three meals during the day and keep the oneness. Because even if I feel hungry, I'll feel good. On the other hand, I could have all three meals without that contact, and all I'd have is an upset stomach. Why? Because if I'm not in contact, I'm not going to digest the food as well. And so the greater the peace within the body, the better the digestive system works. The better all parts of the body work. So meditation is not some holy practice that you say you're more spiritual because you meditate. But it does give us that contact with that inner energy, that inner light, that allows us to feel that sensitivity flowing through our bodies. And to me, there's nothing better in the course of any day. There's no experience, there's no earthly experience that is better than that. Because it is part of sensing a wholeness and a completeness, which is translated into divine love, not personal love, but divine love, which has no limit to it. And so we're renewed each day, and we get this sense, if we see something in a state of meditation, whatever we see within our mind's eye, whatever we see throughout the body, inwardly, gives us this inspiration that there is a lot more to life if we see into another dimension, if we see a god or a goddess, if we see the light, whatever it is that we see. That is then what I call justified faith. There is something beyond our five senses. There is something beyond what our mortal consciousness perceives. And so the affirmation reads, through my daily practice of meditation, my surface level mind is either in conscious or unconscious contact with universal consciousness or God in an inner state of oneness. That simply means when the word unconscious is there, it means you could go into a state of meditation, not necessarily have anything appear before your third eye, but at the same time, you have that contact with that higher energy that's inside of you. And with that higher energy that's inside of you, you then are more a part of that energy. Wherever you go after meditating, you feel the greater spiritual reality inside of you than a sense of personal reality. You know, when we feel a sense of personal reality, the greater that we feel that, the more upset we become. Because personal reality is limited reality. We just feel we're just a little pebble on the beach. Little pebble of sand. On the other hand, our spiritual reality allows us to feel we are on the entire beach. A drop of the ocean versus the ocean. One star in the heavens versus the entirety of infinity. We have an image of ourselves that gives us a sense of the possibility that we are in this state of oneness, excuse me, and whatever we have to do on this daily basis, we are doing. So visualization, every day I take a few moments to visualize or imagine that the entirety of the interior of my body is filled with God's light presence, and I am one with that presence. Now, of course, visualization, people will visualize many, many things. They'll visualize homes, cars, clothes, money, jewels, vacations. Why not just visualize light? Well, somebody might say, well, that isn't definite enough. Light isn't definite enough. In the beginning was God, and God said, let there be light. And from light all things came forth. So you can either practice baby metaphysics and concentrate on specific things, or you can have the entirety of the universe and allow the light to create for you whatever it is that you really need. And when I say you, I mean the God you. You see, we're so used to being goal-centered and goal-oriented in our Western culture. You gotta strive, you gotta strive, you gotta strive, you gotta strive, you gotta strive. But how do we know that we're even striving for the right thing? How do we know that what we're visualizing for is going to be a part of anything that is lasting happiness for any one of us? We don't know that. But if we trust the light, then it's like saying, I turn it over to God. We have an expression that all of you are familiar with, let go and let God. So all we're doing when we visualize the light is saying the light within us is God, and I'm letting go to the light. And from that light, whatever it is that I really need, let me get the foolishness of my personal ego out of the way. Let me clear out all of this mental debris so that I can then really think clearly. The old song, on a clear day you can see forever. Well, with a clear mind, the forever can see through you. It's as simple as that. You become creative. You become part of the creative process of universal mind and life. You don't spend your time plotting out things, but rather you allow things spontaneously to happen in your life. You know, what is real spirituality? Real spirituality is living your life in a spontaneous way in consciousness. In other words, you've left the surface level of your mind up to the divine mind, and the divine mind clicks in. Remember the thoughts in the New Testament, give not thought what you shall say before you're brought before the judges and the tribunal, because verily I say unto you, in those moments the word shall be on your lips. Now, somebody else has got a speech writer, and they're writing out and they're plotting out word for word for word for word. But isn't it better to have the spontaneity come forth? Of course it is. Because when spontaneity happens inside of you, a wonderful thing happens inside of you. You realize that there is a higher consciousness working inside of you that is beyond your intellectual capacity. And sometimes you sit back and you just listen. For the last 47 years in this work, I know what I'm going to speak on. I have a few affirmations here just to make sure that everything is covered, but it's the higher spirit inside of me that's going to cover it. And oftentimes I'll hear things come out of me that is not coming from the personal part of me, but they're divine gems because they're coming from the higher consciousness. And so I can sit back and I can learn while anybody else is learning that's listening. You see, whenever I lecture, I want really nothing to do with the lecture, the personal part of me. I want that inner self to speak through, to get through. When you're dealing with other people, you're practicing mysticism by allowing that to communicate through you. You're allowing that to speak through you. But when you plan and you just try to get down to the minute intellectual detail, then it becomes muddled. The spontaneity is not there. It is mechanical, and basically what you become is a machine. Everything is mechanical. There's gears and levers and everything working inside of you that are intellectual things inside, but there isn't this spontaneity. I remember years ago when William Buckley used to have more television time. And, well, this is the way it is, and blah, blah, blah. And you had this intellect pouring out, but it was boring. I mean, it was so dry. What all of us need is a balance between the inner and the outer life. The intellect simply becomes a tool for the spirit to use. If the intellect rules over us, then we're not practicing the presence, we're practicing the intellect. And reason and intellect and logic can neither save us nor the world. It can't. Because it lacks heart. It lacks spirit. It lacks soul. And lacking spirit, soul, heart, you lack love. Love is the unifying force of the one life running through all of us as a mystical thread that unites each and every one of us. Next says awakening. It says, daily upon awakening from sleep, I affirm and declare that I live this day in mystical oneness with God. All right, how do we stay in that practice each day? Well, when you open your eyes the first thing in the morning, and you establish that you're still here, then what is it that you do? You just simply then go ahead, and I live this day in mystical oneness. That's all. It takes only a moment to say it. I live this day in mystical oneness with God. That's it. How long does that take? Not very long. That means before your feet even hit the floor as you get out of bed, already you have a mindset. Let's suppose you don't do this. Then what do you got? you got the other choice, the personal you. So it's like saying, by not saying it, it's like saying, the personal me lives this day. By not saying it, by a process of mental omission, you haven't geared yourself. I am the universe, and the universe lives through me this day. I am eternal, infinite life, and this is what's lived through me this day. However you choose it, get it out of the personal level. The moment you're in that personal level, you've opened yourself up to woe is me. If, as an example, you woke up and you had a little bit of pain somewhere in your body, and you don't say anything, then immediately the pain becomes personal. But if, on the other hand, you take a moment in spite of the pain and you say to yourself, I am a manifestation of the oneness of the universe, then you have sent a message to the natural healing intelligence inside of your body, and your chances of ridding yourself of that pain, getting a natural healing taking place within your body during the course of that day, is magnified. As to whether, if you don't say it, then again you're on your personal own, as it were. Being on our personal own doesn't make it. It doesn't make it. Sure, we live, we breathe, we eat, we eliminate, but we're just going through bodily processes. We're not actually living. Now, all of you know what I'm talking about. All of you know you have days, and you've had days in your life where you feel more alive, where everything seems more right. And then there are other days where Murphy's Law seems to set in and everything is going wrong. Well, what I'm saying here is, by practicing this presence, by getting off of our personal ego, which is our limitation, neurotic self, our self-indulgent, what is in it for me self. Now, that's part of the difficulties of this particular study when a person doesn't go through traditional religion. That is, because we are so centered on spiritual awakening that we become so self-centered within ourselves that then we become almost narcissistic, in a sense of we can't seem to get out of ourselves, and we are cutting ourselves off from other people, and our mental isolation is leading us to neurosis and problems. It leads then to the escape mechanisms, if you can call them that, because they're really not mechanisms. They lead us down the primrose path of self-delusion and self-destruction. So when you awaken every morning, start the day right. Start it with God. When you go to sleep at night, again, all it takes is a moment. Daily, when I'm ready to retire to sleep, I affirm and I declare that during sleep, I am in mystical oneness with God. Now, we can never be separated from that which we are, but by declaring this, it allows the internal workings of consciousness throughout our being to be more open and receptive and in harmony with our reality. Rather than to close off, we've had problems during the day, our head hits the pillow at night, and if we don't clear those things, then we take all of those troubles, all of those woes, all of those miseries into sleep with us. We take our personal self to bed. I'm sure all of you that know the old idea and so forth between a couple that you should never go to bed angry. Try to clear it up before you go to sleep. Well, just in our own mental solitude, clear up your mind. So every night when your head touches the pillow, as you sleep, you tell yourself, I'm in mystical oneness with God. The next affirmation says, during sleep. During sleep daily, my mind is influenced by my oneness with God for guidance, and thoughts are planted in my subconscious for coming forth into my surface mind level. All right? Dreams that you have during the night are guidance dreams. They can tell you where you've been, where you're at, and where you're going, how well you're doing or not doing in getting there. Dreams become God's messages during sleep if you learn how to interpret dreams and dreams as symbols, dream images as symbols. Then, when you're awakened, and during your waking hours, things that you don't remember during sleep are planted just beneath the surface level of your mind. And as you go through your daily activities, when the time is right, there'll be a trigger mechanism which will call the recollection of that thing that has been implanted into the personal subconscious to come forth into your conscious mind to lead you, guide you, and direct you. Again, you're practicing the presence by practicing the presence 24 hours a day. Not just during your daylight waking hours, but throughout sleep. Because we're inseparable from reality, whether we're awake or asleep. All of you can understand that. And so why not take advantage? Why not put a mindset as you go to sleep? Release daily, I affirm and declare that I choose to live my life in oneness with God and God's will for my life, and so release my personal ego self to my universal selfhood united with God. No man enters the kingdom of heaven except he who doeth the will of my Father. Some of you want to get into a higher state of meditation. Heavenly consciousness, the kingdom of heaven is within. Those words then are mystical words. If you attempt then to do the will of the universe or God, when you go into a state of meditation, your consciousness will be generally more open. And so you open yourself up to that healing vibration inside. Practicing giving up your personal will each day to God's will is practicing the presence, practicing mysticism, practicing oneness. The choice is yours every day. You can either be one with your personal ego or one with the mind and consciousness and spirit of universal life. At meals, daily, at every meal, I take time in my own mind or in some outer way to acknowledge that the food before me is made possible by my oneness with God. Of course it is, because you are God manifesting. You have, the real you, has been in partnership with God to manifest whatever it is that you're supposed to have. Now, some people like to be more physical about showing some type of gratitude or acknowledgement. It may take somebody's hand or something like that. If you want to do that, that's fine. It's up to you. All that you really need to do is just to have a momentary flash in your mind. It doesn't take any outer physical touching or display. It's up to you how you want to do it. The main thing is to acknowledge, whether it's through a physical means of, maybe if it's like a Thanksgiving dinner as an example, to have everybody take the pan of everybody else sitting around a table, or whether it's to get into a prayerful hand position, whatever it might be, or just simply to acknowledge that we're here together. We know that the food that's before us has been provided for us by the true spirit of life within every one of us, and so it is. It's the old idea is different strokes for different folks. That's all. However you choose, however the God inside of you chooses to express, it is the acknowledgement, it is practicing the presence that we just don't have food in front of us. that when we're going through the supermarket and we're putting things into our shopping cart, we recognize that when we get to the checkout counter, that the money that we're going to pull forth, or the credit card or the checkbook or whatever it might be, to have this food is all as a result of our oneness with this great provider. And so it allows us to practice the presence, accomplishing daily all that I do or accomplish is as a result of my oneness with God, to whom I give credit as having been the true doer of all achieved. Constantly over the years, I quote Christ, "Why call ye me good?" King James Version. It is not I, but the Father which doeth these good works. Now, how clearer can that be? What he's saying is, it's not I, Jesus, but the Father that doeth these good works. So if you have something that you accomplish, you don't get into a personal ego trip, which only sets you up for a letdown, because today it's up and tomorrow it's down. Instead, you give credit, where credit is really due to the true self within you, the God self within you, and you're practicing the presence. It keeps us from getting into a state of pitiful self-glory. And that's what I call it, pitiful self-glory. Any of you who have ever spent any amount of time with an egotist know exactly what I'm talking about. It's me, I, me. You think that they're the only ones on the planet. I mean, it can be carried to an extreme. Yeah. Love and blessings. What does that have to do with practicing the presence? Well, it has to do, if we are practicing the presence, we're going to think of love and blessings in terms of godliness. Daily, I take a few moments in my awareness of my eternal oneness with God to send forth into the atmosphere the love and blessing of God's presence to everyone, everywhere. Now imagine for a moment that you've disappeared. Your personality, your body, your soul has disappeared, and you're one with God. You are the light. What are you going to be thinking? Since I am all that I have created, I bless and love all I have created. Even in a very human sense, when somebody creates something and then almost falls in love with their creation, you know, something, the expression, "Well, that's my baby over there, I've created it." A universal scale, we are all the babies, and yet we're the Father, Mother, God at the same time. It's confusing, but it isn't. If we have that sensitivity, you want to get ahead in the world, you think to yourself then, what can I do to bless the lives of others? I don't care what you're trying to do in life. You say, well, why? Because you're going to be holy? No, it has nothing to do with holy. It has to do with following universal law and universal mind. Because You see, if you let's say you're running a restaurant. What can I do to bless the lives that everybody comes into my restaurant? I'm going to give them better food and bigger portions. Or, if I want to take the anti-fast food thing, I'm going to give them better food and smaller portions. I'm going to find a way to make things tasty without putting so much salt into everything. So you run a better restaurant, you're blessing your customers, and what happens? You have a better running restaurant. There are more people to keep your restaurant going. Simple. So it says, daily I take a few moments in my awareness of eternal oneness with God to send forth into the atmosphere. What does that mean, into the atmosphere? Well, more and more science is beginning to realize there is no such thing as space. Mystics know everything is the mind of God. So right here, if there's space between myself and yourself, there really isn't any space. It gives the illusion of space. But in reality, there is what the Hindu calls chitta, mind stuff, that flows between us. There is an unbroken field of energy, matter, maybe undetectable to the naked senses, that exists between all of us, that acts as a conduit, as it were, for our transferring telepathically love and blessings to other people. So when we say we send love and blessings to somebody, you could stand in the middle of your living room and say, I send love and blessings to everybody on the face of this earth, everyone, everywhere. And though it seems to go into thin air, it isn't going into thin air. It's going into a substance that flows through all supposed individualized forms. And so you're blessing everybody as you bless everyone and everyone everywhere on this planet. You can be then blessing the person in China, blessing the person in Israel, while at the same time blessing the person in Lebanon. And maybe if the people in Lebanon and the people in Israel and this person and that person and this movement and that movement get the message through this universal medium, then perhaps there's a chance that the world will not destroy itself. Any one of us is responsible for all of us. Let me repeat this. Every one of us is responsible for all of us. And I just don't mean that we're responsible for our neighbors next door or we're responsible for our families. We are responsible for everyone. That was the real mystical mystery of Christ when he said, I take the sins of the world upon me. Meaning translated into mystical terms, I take the karma of the world upon me. It's a wonderful thing. You know, when we say the first sign of maturity is growing up and meeting responsibility, how much more grown up and mature can we be to say, I take the sins of the world upon me? To realize that everybody that is out there, even those that are doing the worst foul things, are projections of myself. And if I, as one manifestation, am not happy with this, it is I that can change it. As we do this, we are practicing the presence by practicing how God thinks, not how this individual neurotic type of mind, this intellectual, logical, reasoning mind left to its own devices. All that it creates is cunningness more deceit, more manipulation, more of what's in it for me. You know, nearly a half a century in this work, I meet people that have come to me and say, you know, can I have a little bit of your time or whatever? I say, it's not going to do any good. And they look at me, well, how much do you want? I said, there's really nothing you can put out on the table that's going to change my mind, because it's just going to be a waste of time. You're not ready. Well, what makes you think I'm not ready? Because you're thinking only about yourself. You're a taker. I can't do a thing for you. I could put Jesus, Buddha, Spinoza, Socrates, Plato, all the wise people, fill the room with them, and they couldn't get anywhere with you either. Because all you can think about is what's in it for me. You make a friendship, why? What's in it for me? You marry somebody, why? What's in it for me? You go to work for somebody, what's in it for me? How far do you think you're going to get up the corporate ladder? You might go to the head of the union, but you're not going to go into management. You may be making more on an hourly basis, but you're not going to be cashing in on the big levels. Why? Because you're watching that proverbial clock, 5 o'clock, and I'm out of here. The moment anybody thinks like this, they're out of it, all right. The employer will keep them on for what they're doing, if they're doing that satisfactorily. But God help you if you don't do that satisfactorily, because then you're definitely out the door. Because there is no spirit. There is nothing of what I can give, it is only of what I can get, and that is not practicing the presence. God has given us life. God has given us a body. God has given us a soul. God has given us an opportunity. God is a giver, not a taker. So ask yourself, am I a giver or a taker? When I go somewhere, am I thinking, what am I going to get out of it? Is that the center of my focus? Or what can I contribute? There are people that go to church just to network. A flashing of business cards, a flashing of pamphlets. This isn't giving. It isn't godlike. It's what can I get out of it? It's me, I. And so they say to themselves, well, hey, I can rationalize this because God wants me to be prosperous. That's neurotic rationalizing. God wants everybody to be prosperous. There's a time and a place for everything. Think about it. Learn to think. And thinking is learning to be aware. It is thought passing through our minds without our surface level of the mind initiating the thought, but the thought being intuitively brought forth and flowing into our conscious mind, through our conscious mind, through our faculties, through our senses, communicating with the world. Then we're practicing the presence. And when we practice the presence, we practice the power, we practice the wisdom, we practice the love, we practice the healing, we practice everything that every religion has ever attributed to anything that's divine and anything that's godlike.